welcoming Freya Oehle.
Well, thanks for that introduction. Puts the level quite high, so expectations are high. I hope to help them. Thanks for coming. I mean, it's an evening, so you could also sit in a bar, which is always good. I put up a presentation that is probably kind of different of what is considered a lecture, because I'm not so much the lecture type. I wasn't that in university, to be honest, and I'm not now. I actually put together some slides that show how our company really is, because what I was interested most in is who here is actually planning to found a business, or to whom is founding a business an option? Well, that's already great. I hope that after that, everyone is actually wanting to found a business. Because what I did is actually the typical way. I don't know if anyone knows this video. Probably everyone who's German knows it already. It's making fun of business consultants. And I've gone the whole way through. Like, I've been this insecure overachiever that everyone is talking about. I visited business school, did quite well. Then also made my MBA. I actually went to an investment bank during that time. I also, well, visited the industry. And at the very end, I went to a business consultancy focusing on finance and accounting. So the very attractive kind of business that you actually really want to do, because it's all about numbers. And realized that everything that I did there, like sitting in late at night, doing all the projects, was not that much fun. However, I was thinking, okay, I always wanted to found a company, but I never wanted to found a company just to found a company, but I wanted to have a good idea. So I was like, okay, you know what? I'm going to do business consultancy for some time, and then when the idea pops up, I'm going back and found my business. But what happened in the meantime, which was pretty bad for McKinsey, is that I went to the US and saw a business idea that was really badly realized and also very limited, and I asked myself, why doesn't this exist in Germany? I called a friend from school that you just saw here. His major asset is that he knows how to make a computer do what you want to do. And asked him, so I found this idea, which is actually what we're doing now. I have no idea how complicated this is, but this might be an idea that I could go for. 2 weeks later, this smart guy came up with a prototype that was not really nice looking, but actually doing what I wanted it to do. And so I called McKinsey and told them it was really nice to be working for you, and I know that I signed a contract, but I actually won't step out 1st of January. And then founding happened. Just briefly, I don't really want to make advertisement here or whatsoever. What we are doing is Spottster, pretty easily explained. You shop online, whatever shop you can imagine, be it Amazon, Zalando, whatsoever. You see, for example, this beautiful coffee machine of George Clooney, you're like, damn, I really want to have that. But paying more than $100 for a coffee machine, seriously, not gonna happen. So what you do is you hit our button, either on the desktop or in the app. You save the product, like you save a page with Evernote. We keep track of the product. We compare the price every day together with the shop. And we send you an alert whenever it's cheaper. So first task for tonight, download it, use it, so we earn money. That's a nice thing. But the second thing about it, what this makes it perhaps a little different to other stories, is that I really want you to see how founding actually works, because everyone is always saying, hey, I'm founding my startup, I have a startup, but what does it really mean? It means a whole damn lot, work, and no light living standard. For us, I already told you, I went to this lecture in the US, I saw the business idea, I thought that would be nice, called that guy, asked him to build it, he said yes, and so we started prototyping. That all happened during my master thesis, which was in a completely different subject. It was in tax, highly attractive. So I wrote my master thesis, and simultaneously I sat down to write a business plan, while Tobias was prototyping, doing the coding stuff. And then we went to a business angel. First thing that might be a little odd about us, we didn't do it the usual way, like you hear it from Berlin-based startups, that they just went to the network and asked like the very high net worth individuals to just fund because they know them from somewhere. What we did is cold calls. Cold calls meaning we had an email, we had a business plan, we sat down at our computer and we Googled for people with a lot of money. And we Googled for people who already invested in startups. And then we also had a list from, you know the High-Tech Gründerfonds, for example? That's like a German institution that provides founding capital. So we looked at who's actually financing this fund, who's actually giving his money into this fund. and we tried to find out email addresses and just send out our business plan, and it actually worked. I think it was the sixth email that we sent out, we ended up sitting in Frankfurt in front of a 33-year-old guy who had a billion on his account. Not a million, but a billion. And the first question he asked us was, well, you have a prototype, you have a business plan, why don't you just pay it yourself? That was the weirdest situation I was ever in, because you're sitting in front of a guy and trying to tell him, I'm a student, all that I earn is what I can possibly do with my two hands on my head. That was the first situation that we actually had to get through, and then he decided to actually fund us. That was about 3 months after I had the idea and actually went back to Germany to write my master thesis, so it all went very quick. But then, and that is a phase hardly anyone ever talks about, comes the phase that you really hate. If you have to do negotiations, if you have to actually get a contract and get the whole thing done, that took us about 2 months, this phase in there. Like, we visited him in Frankfurt, that was a 3-hour meeting. He said, yes, I could probably fund you. And from that moment onwards, in May until August, we had to struggle with this lawyer. Lawyers are not fun. Lawyers are difficult, but, and that is one reason why I always say, found your own business. I actually grew within this 2 months, in terms of knowledge, self-confidence, more than I would ever do if I was an employee. Because you have to fight for yourself, you have to tell this lawyer, if we're going to write this into the contract, I'm off, I'm not doing that. Then you have like your co-founder sitting beside you like, you know that he's not giving us money if you do that, right? And you're like, yeah, but this is really bad, this hurts, so you really have to negotiate and make your point, which you never had to do beforehand when you were studying. Afterwards, everything is easy, but in between, that is the hard part, how it works. I don't know how many have experience in that, but for us, it was we had the idea, we did the pitch. After the pitch comes the due diligence, so they're checking your business plan, which is pretty easy because you have about 30 pages that can be checked. And afterwards comes the term sheet and the negotiations. And in a whole, you take about 3 to 4 months to get money. So if you have a plan to do financing for your company, start early. Start as early as possible. Even if you think we have a lot of resources, you don't. You never have. Question? Oh. Something else that I, for example, was not told and I think is really funny, because I studied business, and then we actually were sitting there, we had a contract, the lawyer was happy, we were happy, what's next? We had no idea. We had to go to the notary to get it signed. First thing, I was told in business school, you have to make sure that you have about 25,000 euros if you found a company. So I was calling my bank and was saying, I have to make sure that we have 25,000 euros on an account, because the notary has to know that. The bank told me, you cannot have an account for your company if you haven't been through the notary. So I was sitting like, how am I supposed to do that? Am I just walking in there with cash in my hands? So I actually called the notary and was like, I have a problem here, because my bank doesn't allow me to set up an account, but you want to know that I have 25,000 euros at my hand. How am I going to do that? I cannot walk in with a cash case. Started to laugh. Was really embarrassing and told us, you first come here, you sign your contract, you then go to the bank, set up a bank account, come back to me. I hand it in to the Handelsregister, awful institution. This Handelsregister will check whether everything's okay. Then the equity invest comes in. The equity invest is not the whole invest that you get, but it's a minor part of it. It's only about perhaps 10% max of what you actually get for money. So all the way through up to there, which takes about 6 to 7 weeks, you don't have any money on your account, because the Handelsregister takes about 4 weeks to look at one sheet of paper and say, oh yes, we have a company. After 4 weeks, you get a confirmation of your company, so you can actually start to work, meaning you can get the big amount of money from your investor, and you then start. So this is another 6 to 7 weeks that you really have to wait. Nobody told me beforehand. We were nearly running out of money, although there was a billionaire sitting and telling us, I have money and I'm giving it to you. But still, we didn't have it at the moment, so we really scratched our personal funds to the very odd limits. Another thing, I don't know if anyone is aware of this, but this is something really important that you're not taught and that most notaries don't believe you to do. Our notary is actually telling me that what I'm doing there is wrong, and so we told him why we're doing that. If you found a company, just scribble that down, keep that in mind, never directly found a GmbH. but always put a UG in front of it if you actually found in Germany. It's kind of a private holding. The only sense of it is if you actually go to the notary and say, I myself, as Freya Oehle, found a GmbH, I have to pay income taxes on that because it's what I earn personally. But if I go ahead, found a minor company, a UG, and then say, this UG is giving money to found a GmbH, it's not my personal earnings anymore. My personal earnings sit right here. But those earnings that come from the GmbH, which is my actual company, where I make millions of dollars with a set of Facebook, is actually just an investment. Investments are taxed with 15% in Germany. Personal earnings, 45%. So you lose a lot of money. And of course, my UG needs a car, a computer. Whatsoever you can buy to make business, you can actually do with the UG afterwards. Saves you 30% of taxes. Every notary above 50 years of age will tell you that this doesn't really make sense because he already does the math that, well, 30% and 50% add up to 45%, so there is no advantage for you, but actually from a tax perspective, there is a huge. And this is something that you have to be told once, you will never do something else, but nobody really tells you. Next thing on personal advice, what we've learned, sweat is the best equity you have. It's what I told you already. I was told, why don't you finance it yourself? Because all you can do is work. Get your ass down to work. Have a prototype ready. Go as far as you can before you raise any penny of money. Because every month that you actually work more drives your valuation if you're working hard. And whenever you go to an investor, that is the common mistake we also made because we were 23 years of age, you go there and you're kind of nervous because you want that person to give you some money for nothing that is existing. Don't be nervous and don't go there bidding someone to give you money. What you do is you go there and tell them, I have an opportunity for you. I will work 24/7, which makes up a salary of about 80,000 euros entry salary for you to get this idea done. And afterwards, you might be having a return that is higher than anything you can earn, especially if, well, sitting there down to 1%. But you tend to do that. You tend to go there and be kind of modest about what you're doing, but you're really offering your workforce, you're offering your idea, and you want the money in return. So it's a fair ground. That is something that every founder founding the first time does wrong, us including. If I would go to an investor right now, I would never actually be in a reserved position, but just go there and say, I have a great idea. You have the opportunity to join. Tell me why you are a good investor and not the other way around. Second thing that I would actually tell you to do, never start too small. Nowadays, if I would have an idea and only have a business plan as I used to have back then, I would go there and say, I need $2 million and my company is worth $10 million. No matter whether that's true or not, because if you have a business plans are awesome things because they don't exist. Nobody can prove you wrong. All you can do is you can do the math and tell them why that might be right. They can argue why that might be wrong and you can meet in the middle so you still have 1 million. But, and that is what we did, you normally start modest and think, well, it's easier to raise a small amount of money, so let's start with that so we can get started. Don't do that, because if you have money, you have to start to work. Once you start working, you produce real numbers, real sales, numbers that can be seen, that can be actually controlled. So if you have to raise more money and you go to another investor and already have worked and you have numbers on your account, every investor will use that and tell you, well, I don't think that you're worth 10 million because if I look at those numbers, I don't see the potential and those numbers are real, so you cannot really do anything about it. So if you start, raise as much as you can in the beginning and then run. Something that you have to be sure about when founding, I mean, I came from investment banking and consultancy and I was thinking that is so much more freedom and that is so much more free time. It isn't. You have to do everything. You have to clean the office, you have to build chairs, you have to put on the TV on the wall, although you don't have any idea how that works. You have to take care of the team. You don't have a work-life balance, you have work. And if you want to have a life balance, find a partner that goes along with that and comes to the office to bring you something to eat. Something that is also really important that I learned, I came from business school, we always had business plan competitions where you had to write the perfect business plan. Your business plan won't be worth anything after about half a year of work normally. Every investor knows that. Every investor tells you that if you ask for it, but you always think that the plan has to be perfect. It doesn't. The plan is actually to check whether you can do the plus and minus, whether you're right set in your mind and not totally crazy, and to just see that you put some thoughts in what you want to do and that you have some goals. But afterwards, for example, we ask our first investor, okay, we've got one short question. Why actually did you invite us to come to Frankfurt? I mean, you're a billionaire. We just wanted a small amount of money. There's no real reason for it. And he just told me, that was a fun fact, you know, when you sent me that mail containing the business plan, you kind of twisted a site or quote of Goethe. And I was thinking, now that is interesting. A young person that can cite Goethe, I should have a look at that. That is why he actually invited us. And I was like, oh, great. So it wasn't about the business plan, the product. Well, it looked good. Okay. And then we went there, and then he said, and then you came in as a team. And I watched how you two work together, how you share your parts and talking. I was thinking, this is a good team, so I'm investing. And every investor nowadays tells you, I'm only investing in good teams. So be sure. I come from a business school that everyone wants to found, so they always make up teams where you have a business consultant, investment bank, and a business consultant. Awesome team. You always have the alpha ego running around there, but you don't have a technician. You don't have what you need. So make sure, no matter how good you like your friends, that you have a person that is complementary to you, a person that actually brings in input more than you could, which for us is makes perfect sense because technically I'm a leg tennis. I cannot do anything technically. Next thing, you all have to love presentations. That also holds for a programmer. If you are not able to actually talk about your product all the time and you don't love your product, forget founding it. Because, for example, for me, on parties, I switch to say that I want to become a teacher. Makes it so much easier if you want to have your drink. Because normally if you tell people, yeah, I founded a company, you're stuck in there. You have to talk about your company all day long. Everyone is asking what you're doing. The other one didn't hear it, so you have to repeat. If you just end up becoming an English teacher, everyone is fine with that. Then something that I actually don't often share with people, but I thought that would be nice, because the first thing that I was thinking about, well, I cannot found a business in online shopping, because for a matter of fact, I hate shopping. I really do. Be it online or offline, it's not my kind of thing to do. Plus, I have no idea about the internet. I didn't know how to code anything. And I have no idea about graphics. You can see that we didn't, because this is our first company logo, made up with Word, beautiful program. This was an idea of my brother, how our logo could look like. And we're like, nah, I don't know. It's kind of weird to me. Then we decided to call it Spottster. And again, we used Microsoft Word because we needed just a visualization for the business plan. This is the logo that was actually in our business plan because it didn't really matter. Afterwards, we actually hired a designer and it cost us about $2,000 to get a logo and a web page. And the logo looked like this afterwards. Fun fact, all our friends afterwards said, but I don't see it. Did it really work? I mean, did you pay for that? It looks quite the same. We're like, well, perhaps. But the thing is, it worked with that logo, getting an investment. Same holds for the homepage. The drawing that you can see here, like the bag with all this funny stuff coming out, was done by my brother again. Looked better than the logo, so we took it. And that was the homepage, the prototype with which we went to the investor. This is how our program explanation looked like, because we knew we needed an explanation for him so that he could get it, but it was just there, just to make something visual. And this is how the lists look like. This is how we raised money. Then, again, we paid this designer. This is what the designer made out of it. It's quite the same again. This is how the explanation looked afterwards, and this is how the lists looked like. But the bad thing about that was, I mean, it was good that they did it, but after about 2 weeks, we were actually not able to look at our webpage anymore. We're like, we don't like the colors. We have to work with that. So we should better change it. And we were not willing to pay another investor, but we had learned so much in about 2 months about graphics, about the internet, just by doing it, that we said, okay, let's do it ourselves. So we took Photoshop and created a totally new page from our perspective with trendsetters, lists, got background pages, got descriptions, and something we're really proud of, this is our new front page, which we did ourselves. The watch that you can see over there is actually the watch that I'm wearing at the moment. I can show you pictures, how we took pictures of it on a table from IKEA with our camera on top of it, but it worked. And the message behind that is you don't really have to be an expert in the idea that you actually want to realize. You just have to want to do it and put everything in there and then just be creative. Which brings me to the next one. We are a bootstrapping company. You can see our first office over there. This is our first team photo. It actually went through press. It was done with a self camera. And the light that you can see came from a desk light because we didn't really have a light like this in here. That's how we are now. We have an office in St. Pauli where there's actually light coming in and things are structured. And our team is about 10 people at the moment, still growing. But, and that is the fun fact, you always see the shiny part of startups, like how much money they're worth and how good this all works. Most startups in the beginning were kind of a group of freaks that were just sitting together in the least location that you wanted to be and started to work there in complete chaos. We always have chaos in our office, still now. This is how Apple started in the garage. But there are more examples to that. This is it wasn't a garage. That was, I think, a gardening house of Google where they started to code. And this is how Twitter started. It's a bunch of friends that just did it from their place where they were studying. So if you think about startups, do me one favor. Don't think about shiny offices in Berlin. Don't think about that you have like the coolest spot like Google with play toys around. You start where you are. When you have a desk, you can actually work. So this is how it looked for us. It was in a cellar, making clear by this. This is our window. As we were in the cellar right next to the heater, we didn't really have daylight. You can see that there is like this black line in there, but 50% of our windows were covered by something gray that we cannot actually identify until now. And there were jars in front of it because it was like the ground layer of the building. And if you wanted to have sun, you really had to scratch out for that, as you can see here. But how did it went on? Like, we actually started, we got the invest, we launched our product, we expanded to Great Britain and starting marketing over there right now. We did our second round of financing, so this is why we can afford daylight at the moment. And we also got into TV, which brings me to the next thing that you should actually consider, media. You're a startup, you don't have money. Marketing costs a hell lot of money. You don't know that beforehand, but if you want to set up an account with Google and you tell Google, I want to do online advertisement, Google tells you, oh, that's nice, we can start at about 25,000 euros a month. That's our startup rate. You're like 25,000 euros a month for Google alone. You haven't paid $1 of wages at that moment. So that's really expensive. So you have to be in the media everywhere. We did that quite well. We don't know why. One factor is we have a female founder and media loves that at the moment. So for the boys, if you find a woman that wants to fight with you at the moment, do it because real press will hunt you down. But what you have to know about media, and that is what we also learned, you have to have a story, and media has its own. So you really have to be careful if you go to the media, what you're telling it, when you're telling it, and how you put it, because media actually does what is interesting. We were in a television show. We had a pitch that was perfect. We got a lot of good comments from the entire jury. One even invested because our pitch was really good. And then there was 1 minute where one of the investors said, there's one fact, I'm invested in your, in your competitor. And we went out of this studio and we're like, this went pretty well. I mean, we were afraid beforehand that it could go wrong and we actually blame ourselves on television. We went out, but we were really positive that it got broadcasted. And this 1 minute was stretched to about 5 minutes with comments like, they run out of money and they will be really ruined afterwards. Fun fact, we already had two investors. In the moment we were standing there, we never told the TV channel that we would actually be running out of money because we weren't. But for media, we were. So don't believe what you see in the media. And if you go for the media, be sure that you actually make a story that is worth and sure of what you're telling. That is something that we learned with newspapers. We had a lot of coverage with newspapers. We always ask, who's your PR agent? We don't have one. If you go to PR agents, asking them, I'm a startup, I want to get into newspapers. They tell you, this is 3,000 euros a month. And you're like, okay, 3,000 euros a month is about 6 interns. If you have 6 interns sitting down at their desk and searching for email addresses every day and writing emails, come on, it's not so hard. So we decided to do it ourselves. And what we learned there is, I come from a household, my father's like humanistic building, you always have to be really good in German and to use old words and grammar has to be perfect. But this works, that makes you different because startups at the moment tend to be over hip. If you talk to journalists, they're often really pissed because they get emails like, hey dude, my name is Tom, I have a startup, check it out. And they're like, what the hell are those guys thinking, seriously? Because what they actually want you to do is to set up a story. Why are you interesting for the effort set, the economy part of the effort set? They want you to be polite. And they want you to really be kind of sticking out of the crowd. That's what they told us. And for us, we always wrote letters with Z in there, like the formal U in German. We always used words that hardly anyone used. Sound kind of weird, but it worked out. And when we were addressing the FAZ, we didn't just tell them, we are a startup that is keeping track of price. Is that interesting for you? But what we did is we did a price analytics, we had a whole story done, and then we wrote to that newspaper and told them, look at this. We took about 55 million products and we found out that there are differences in the day you shop, in the month you shop, that prices differ a lot, and that, for example, vouchers are really important for online shoppers and they all don't know about that. Isn't that interesting for a story for you? And that is how we got in. So prepare stories beforehand, tell them what would be interesting, and then send it to them because journalists are lazy people, really lazy people. Actually, if you type in, well, mistakes that you know you did and you find them printed, that is the moment where you realize, okay, you have to be the own journalist and just send the story to the journalist because if it's interesting, he's passing by. If not, your chance is ruined and don't be too hip. Next thing, bootstrapping, we do that still. We're still cleaning our offices ourselves. We're still doing anything that has to be done, and the fun fact about it is that it's actually good. A lot of founders from the US who have done bootstrapping are still doing it. I'm not saying you have to have like a bigger office now and you have to have everything, catering, coffee, whatsoever, because bootstrapping actually keeps you creative. That is what we learned from our employees also. If you don't have the resources to do something, you have to solve the problem yourself. And there's a funny story that I was once told. Amazon started in Europe and they had a new employee. They didn't have a table. So his chief just told him, you know what, there's a door, take the door out, just put something beneath it and you have a table. That is why nowadays in Dublin there is still always one desk at Amazon that is built out of a door. Because if you don't have the resources, you just do it. And that is what our employees, for example, did themselves, which is really amazing. We didn't have anything like a kicker or sports or whatsoever because we didn't have the money. So one day, one of our employees came up, you know, 1 euro shops, I love them. You can get everything for 1 euro, it's insane. He came up with this 1 euro table tennis set and put it up on his desk for the lunchtime. It was like, I'm putting it down after lunch, but I want to have table tennis in the office. Became a team sport at us. Second thing is, I once went by a construction site and you have those cable cars over there where they put the cable on and they had that like for spare. And we're standing, I was like, this is really a nice table. Could I take that one? The construction workers were looking at me as if I were totally crazy, and I just put it back into the office and it actually became our table. Then a journalist took a photo of that, how we are holding meetings at this table. And we won a complete conference room from an interior company because they saw that and were like, we're taking you, we're promoting that, and we're going to get you a new conference room. So we didn't pay anything, but got one just for that table. Second thing is we have this logo made up in our office. It looks really fancy. We love it a lot. It costs us about 8 euros in total. Because one of our employees once came up with this thick kind of paper. It's really like that, costs about 3 euros, can get it in every office discount. And then we had a printer. So we printed out all the logos on normal paper, stick it up with glue and just put it on the wall. It looks really nice, took us 8 euros. And we wouldn't have that if people didn't want to actually build something. And that is a nice invention of one of our interns. Working conditions are great at Spottster. This is the room where we keep all the tools. There's no daylight. Actually, there are all the old bottles in there. You can find a lot of empty Club Mate bottles around. We didn't have like the full 360 degrees perspective because it doesn't have 360 degrees in that room. And she put out a blackboard. We thought she was taking notes in there because she always went into that room to make phone calls because it's not even the size of this desk. But she actually put it up to make a view out of it, and we have the harbor of Hamburg now in that office that you cannot show to anyone. And then the next thing is that you have to find a team apart from your co-founder. There are times when you cannot work every day until 3 o'clock at night, so you have to hire. Problem is, you don't have any money. So the question is, why should people come to you? And what we've realized, we had no idea why people were actually applying for our company, because our very first application, we had to interview in a bakery because we were sharing the room in the cellar that you just saw, that one without daylight, with another startup, and they were annoyed if we were talking loudly. So we had to take him to the bakery and do the entire assessment center at the baker. We just went out of that store and was like, if that guy is going to sign, he's completely out of control. And he signed. The reason was, he told us he liked the team, he liked the idea, and he liked the enthusiasm that we were putting into it. So he said, this is way more fun than working in a big company where nobody really cares about what we do. What we do is we care a lot. I mean, I have worked hard, so I expect everyone to work as hard as that, but still, if somebody does something really good, we're proud of it, and we show that this is a Facebook post that we did because one of our interns passed his bachelor's degree. And this is something that you should actually keep in mind. Positive feedback gets you a lot of employees because people like to be praised for what they do. Second thing is, if you don't have any money, ask your family to do nice things and ask your mother to send over sweets for Christmas, Nikolaus, and birthdays. And just keep that in mind for your employees, because you actually like to work at a company where you get a t-shirt for your birthday, although you normally would be able to buy about 3,000 t-shirts for what you don't earn there. Still, people like the t-shirt more than earning 3,000 euros more a month. And something else, make it visible. Make everyone a team member. That is something that we've learned, because the FAZ article that you just saw was written by an intern, because I didn't have the time. I was standing there, we had this FAZ thing going on, and I didn't have the time because we had a fundraising round. So she was there for about 2 months and had to write the whole article for a nationwide newspaper. She wasn't prepared for that at all. She studied psychology. So this is something where we learned everyone is worth exactly the same. We don't have something like boss or whatsoever in the company. If you find something that is bad, you tell them. If somebody's coming in, we just make a tax of it, and you have 2 interns here and 2 full-time employees, and you cannot tell the difference. I'm pretty sure that you will guess wrong if you would have to guess who's intern and who's full-time employment. And then something that is often the best factor that you should actually keep in mind, because if you own a company before and as a student, you like fun at work a lot. If you own the company, you have to report to your investors. You actually get kind of nervous when people are running around, playing games, doing stuff that is not really related to work. So you become kind of the general in the firm. Still, what we realize is that this really helps, because people stay late to have water pistol fights. Don't ask me why. If you set up a barbecue, people stay for lunchtime, don't go away. And this fun leads to the fact that everyone stays late and works more than they did before. And although you're always nervous about them doing stuff that you really don't want. Jasmine, for example, she doesn't like to sit at a table. It's kind of a problem if you do computer work. So she just lay on the ground. You just come into your office and you see that somebody's lying on the ground typing on the computer. And you're like, didn't you just find your desk? She's like, oh, I'm better here. And actually, she's more productive on the floor since she works on the floor. And last but not least, this is like a highlight, still bootstrapping motors. We actually set up traditions. This is our Friday tradition. It's called Bobby Car Bowling. We have a Bobby Car in our office and a lot of other toys that actually just came along the way. And we do Bobby Car Bowling every Friday. It's great fun. Doesn't cost 1 euro. And you actually get money for those bottles. And we have some competition, serious competitions going on that. So you can make bets. You have 10 people betting on how many bottles will actually be thrown. And the good factor about that, and that is why I think those things are really important, our employees at the moment are not hired on the free market. We don't have one employee that was not actually brought in by another employee. And if you ever have to hire developers, very rare species, very shy, never coming out of their holes, you have a problem if you don't have a company atmosphere where your own developer says, I could imagine that my friends could be working here because they would enjoy it. So at the moment we have 6 developers, and 5 of them are friends from friends from friends that we somehow got into our company because we're always inviting people to do stuff like that. And this is something that I highly recommend. Don't be too serious, because if you really want to have people working for you, you don't have the money to have high salaries, you don't have the money to pay a headhunter, although they try to sell your services all the time. So you have to actually get people to think, this company is so cool, I could imagine my best friend being working here and not feeling bad about it. And that is something that we actually made up by bottles. So that is pretty much it. So you saw a lot of things that we're doing. This is real world, and I always love those presentations with a lot of photos so that you see how startup really works, because startup is not professional. Startup is kind of students sitting down and just continuing what they did at school. And even if you think about the startup shiny world, it really isn't. It's just hard work. It's improvised, but it's creative.
Thank you very much.
So if you'd like to open the floor to questions, I'll hand over to Krista.
Thank you very much. That's exactly the world that we live in. But I met you at another occasion. I met Freya when she was awarded at a huge gala called Victress Awards, where every year outstanding females get awarded, you know, for the social impact they deliver, for the scientific impact, or for their economic impact or economic prowess. And that is precisely what Freya got, I think, in March or April this year. Right, and that's where I saw her giving her thank you speech, and I was so happy about that, because she was such an enthusiastic entrepreneur on stage that I knew that I had to bring her here eventually. And so this goes full circle now, 8 months later. That's why, you know, we now have the pleasure to see Freya tell the story of her company. But back then, what I was especially impressed by was that you took such a firm stand on entrepreneurship as such. You've now showed us like the result of you, you know, wanting to be an entrepreneur. But back then, you really said that becoming an entrepreneur was the best decision of your life, and that more people should be taking this one.
It's nice.
Why is that so? And what can we do about it? How are you encouraging people to become entrepreneurs? Is that even something that people can be encouraged about, or is that something that you either find for yourself or will never do?
A lot of questions. First question, why do I think it's the best decision? I mean, I've done a lot of work beforehand, and I've never been that positive about what I'm doing every day. The shower is like my creative spot. If I'm standing in the shower, I start to think where other people sing. And at the moment, it's like you get up every morning, and you know you have to go to work. You have to be punctual, although you have a startup because you have employees. So this dream of I go to work whenever I want doesn't work for a startup, because if everyone comes when they want, nothing's going to happen. So you have to be punctual, but still, even if you work late at night, standing in a shower and thinking I have to go to work, it's never I must go there and I really don't want it, but it's like, oh, I had this idea, what can we do about that? And once you realize that you really enjoy going to the office because it's fun around there and you really are into the product, that is something that, I don't know, I cannot describe. It's way better than anything that I've done before. And because before it was always stay up late at night, and then at the next morning you think, oh god damn it, it's another 18 hours. You dress up nicely, although you never leave the building. You're honored if you are allowed to do one phone call. That was my highlight in investment banking. I was allowed to call the client once because everyone else was in a meeting and I had to postpone it. That was my highlight. Client contact. And it's different in a startup because you just do everything and nobody's really asking for permission, but you have to work with journalists, you have to work with developers, you have to do it, and there's no getting away from it, but also there's no somebody's tearing you away from it and telling you you're not allowed to because you're too young. So every idea you have, you can actually realize, and that makes work way more fun. And the other thing is, if you think about your productive hours a day, and you're sitting in a consultancy or wherever you work and do your Excel sheets and whatsoever, just think about the fact that is what made me turn around and say I'm becoming an entrepreneur, how much you could actually do in those, let's say 12 hours if you have a good employer, 12 hours every day of your time. Think about how much that could be an output if one really lets you. And that was a calculation that kind of got me to the point, because I was sitting there 18 hours a day and the result was about 6 more PowerPoint slides that we could hand into the customer. And I was thinking about 18 hours, 6 slides, I can do more than that. And that is when I actually started to think about getting an entrepreneur. Second question, whether everyone should or can be encouraged to become an entrepreneur. I think yes. I do believe yes. I mean, there are a lot of people who don't have the spirit to just run their way and do what they want. But actually, when we started, I come from a family, my father's working for the state. A beamta. Try to tell somebody like that that you're turning down an entry salary that he never had after he has paid for your university, by the way, that you're going to found an own business. I was thinking that my parents were actually not really happy about it, but they were. They supported us in every step. And the fun fact is that at the moment, if you tell friends that you founded a company, everyone wants to help you. Everyone is like, oh, that's awesome. I always wanted to do that myself. Can I help you somehow? And you're like, if you wanted to do that yourself all the time, why didn't you just do it? If you talk to elder German people, especially engineers, who have a real firm knowledge of technology whatsoever, nearly everyone tells you that he or she had an idea and putting it into a company would be awesome, but they just don't do it. So I think if you encourage people and just tell them this is how a startup works, it's pretty groundwork. It's you just sit down and do whatever you want to do and try it. If you fail, you do something else. Everyone is actually wanting to do it. For example, the younger brother of my co-founder, he hasn't gone to university or whatsoever. He has just passed school and then went into a company, got a traineeship. It's the German Ausbildung. I think it doesn't really exist in English. And at the moment, he is actually working for a startup because 2 years after we founded and he saw his brother being a founder, being in this fun surrounding, doing what he likes, he quit his old job, which was in the countryside of Germany, went to Berlin and started to work in a startup, although he had no experience at all with it. Just because you said it looks fun, and I mean, I've got about 40 more years of work, so I just try it. And that is why I think everyone can be encouraged. And the only thing that it takes is work motivation and a little pressure from oneself so that you really can set yourself goals and go there. And I think, I already told Chloe, I'm not so much this active emancipation person, so I'm not really pushing for a female quota or anything like that, or saying, oh, I'm a female founder, look at me. I'm telling it to all the men, because I've always worked with men. I did finance and accounting where there are only men around. But the thing that I think is awesome at the moment is that everyone is talking about startups, female startups and male startups, and that shows you that everyone can do that, no matter whether they have the experience or not. And so I'd say yes, and I hope that everyone in here wants to become an entrepreneur because you won't regret it.
Okay, I have a question. And you mentioned that you saw the idea in the States and thought, well, this can be better executed. What made you, first of all, so sure that the idea could be better executed, and secondly, that you, with your co-founder, could execute it better?
The first question is easy because the product in the US was... Do you still know those Windows 98 explain videos where there's this mouse and it's yellow and shining so that you can see what the mouse is doing? This is how they explained their product in 2012. I was sitting in front of the PC and our professor told us that this startup is founded with $1 million from the Winklevoss brothers, who actually had the idea for Facebook. And you sit in front of a computer and see this yellow, shining mouse running around telling you where to click, and you just think to yourself, $1 million? Come on. That was the first moment where I realized I can't do better than that. Second was, it was limited to fashion only. There was no concern about e-commerce pricing or whatsoever. So those two founders, who actually were fashion retailers beforehand, they didn't really get the scope for the entire market, but just for one niche. And second question, I was never sure whether we could do it better or not, together with Toby. I never knew it. It was just, he was the person who could code, and I knew how to write a business plan, and I had done e-commerce beforehand, so I was thinking it's a good match. Let's see. You can never be sure. That is the fun part about founding. You never know what's going to happen.
Hi, I have a question. How many angels did you contact at cold? You said you were cold calling, and then my second question would be, how much did you actually raise in the first round?
We were cold calling about 50, which is a pretty good quota. That is something that you also have to realize. You have to send out a lot of emails, business plans, pitches to actually get an invest. Out of those 50 emails, we were invited to 5, which is conversion rate of 10%, which is awesome. And one actually got it, and we raised 150,000 in the first round.
From only one angel?
Yes. Yeah. That is also something that I can advise to everyone. If you raise money, try to keep the pot low. Don't get in too many people in there, because in Germany you have a lot of partners from banks or consultancies who would actually love to be a business angel, but they always invest between 10 and 50,000 euros. That's it. That's the amount that they actually are willing to sell. That takes you a lot of time, A, to get the parties together, B, to do the whole administration, and C, for the next years of your company, you always have about 6 to 8 persons at the table that you have to report to, that have to actually make decisions together with you. And if you raise more money afterwards, you easily have a table full of 20 people that are all concerned with your company. So whenever you have the chance to keep the pot low and to just have one party at the table, I would always go for that. That works out way better than having 8. We had an offer from 8 business angel in the last round, wanted to put their money together. And our business angel, who has a lot of companies, just told us, you know what, if you really need the money, take it. But if we have to take in 8 persons for that amount, I'd rather do it myself. Because he had the experience that the more investors you get in, the more complicated and the slower the company gets.
So I have another question. And you've talked a lot and very interestingly about what's happened sort of to date, how you got to the point that you're at. So what's next?
Good question. At the moment, we're working at a B2B solution that we are kind of programming at the moment, because we got a lot of users, so we have a lot of data that we can actually put into information. Second thing is that we want to expand as quick as possible to the rest of Europe, because it's a highly scalable business model. You can do all that with a few people from one spot in Europe. So next year there will probably be another investing round. A lot of fun. But it might be a bigger one, so VCs coming in to actually expand the business to more than 5 to 8 countries.
And for now, are you really focused, obviously you're just entirely focused on Spottster, but sort of looking kind of long-term as, you know, your career as a founder, as an entrepreneur, could you see yourself doing something different?
Yes, perhaps. There are a lot of ideas in our hats that we could actually realize. The thing that I wouldn't change is sticking to the startup or venture industry. That is something that I realized, because it's so much more fun to work there, it's so much more vivid, it's so much more driven by innovation. Plus, being an inferior now, like having a big organization on top of me with all hierarchies and I have to go there and ask for permission, I'm kind of ruined concerning that, because if you had the freedom once to do whatever you want, don't ask for permission, going back to a company that is big and where you have to ask people, it's kind of difficult.
I know you haven't been at this for such a long time, but are there things that, looking back, you would have done differently? And I tell you why I'm asking that, because there was at least two times during your presentation where I kind of went like, what? That is the total opposite of what I always tell people to do. And, you know, it is my job to tell people what they should do, right? Especially founders. The first time was when you gave us the story about cold calling and sending out presentations, because everybody in our industry says, don't do that, it's such a waste of time. Get warm contacts, get introduced, present at big events, get well known, you know, so that you don't have to do that. It's the worst thing. And even investors tell you that straight ahead, that they get like unsolicited pitches, like 1,000 of them over the course of a year, and they often don't even read them. While they get like 50 warm introductions by friends and through the network, of which they invest into 5, which is like 10% again. So that's less than 1 per 1,000 on the one hand, and 1 in every 10 on the other hand. So that was the first time I thought, well, you know, why? I mean, should you really? And would you really recommend that? Because that's what you did. And the second time was when you said that when you're looking for investors, don't have any numbers ready. Because everybody here will say, well, no, I mean, you have to have early traction. You have to prove what you can do. Is this real business? While you were saying, well, sell them your dream, you know, because as soon as you have numbers, the dream will fall apart. You know, and in Germany, everybody says, look, nobody will give you money for a dream. You know, you need to turn the dream into something that's tangible and that's worth the investment. So those were 2 points where I would say, well, would you do that again? Or am I wrong? But are there maybe also other points where, looking back, you would have started differently?
Actually, for the first point, I would do it again, definitely. Because, I mean, what is the point of a business angel saying that it was a cold call, so I didn't have a look at it? He probably didn't open the email, see, oh, I don't know that person, there's no intro in it, so I don't read it. But he probably read it, and it was not really good. If you get an email that is not really good, or where you think, oh, this could be better, but somebody recommended it to you, you take a second look. But if you read something that you don't like and you don't know the person, you don't take a second look. So you just don't even open the attachment. You just delete it, which I would do myself. So if you do cold calling, you really have to actually optimize what you're writing in terms of length, in terms of speech, in terms of everything. But we actually made the experience that everyone was actually responding, at least saying no. And concerning the warm contacts, it is easier, definitely. Still, the problem about your first financing round is that normally you have like the usual suspects when you do your warm contacts. Those are people that invest in startups all the time. You're just another number that comes up and says, I have a business plan. He's like, ooh, something new. But if you do cold calling and actually address people that actually normally never really get addressed that high frequented, it's easier to get your foot into the door. And something that actually proved that for us was that we were, for example, invited by Benedikt Rodenstock, who's having his own VC, by Martin Zinner, who had Idealo. I could have made a warm contact because I had some friends at my university who know him. But we just said it's way faster if we just drop it off like that and he can read it. If he likes it, he likes it. If he doesn't, he doesn't. They all wrote back. Also, Heiko Huberts in Hamburg. I had no idea of him beforehand and just did some research and found out, oh, he sold, I think, Bitcoin for some double-digit $1 million. Perhaps you could contact him. And he even wrote back from his holidays. So I think this don't do cold contacting doesn't really hold true. You have to be sure what you send out and that it isn't spreaded that much, but still I would do it again. Although it's slower, but in the beginning it's easier. And the second question was about numbers. I didn't say don't have numbers ready. I would never do that. I'm into numbers. I like financials. I like accounting, sadly. But you should have numbers ready, of course. You should have something where you say, I calculated this, I looked this up, this is the statistics, and speaking logically, this is something that would come out, and if you count one and one together, it makes two. Of course, every time, everything else I wouldn't invest in either. But having a business plan and sticking to it all the time doesn't work because you are not a glass ball. You don't know what's coming up. And the second thing is, if I didn't say don't have numbers, but if you don't have numbers that are real, but just have a business plan, and you can explain to me why you think those numbers could turn out, it's easier. Once you have numbers and you prove, you really have to have good numbers. And if you have a business plan, you know, of course have good numbers. You wouldn't make an inverse hockey stick. That would be nonsense. So your numbers are always good if you have a business plan, but they're not always good if you have reality or they're not matching expectations because you don't know what the person on the table is expecting. If you just say we have a high return, that's what I think, that's fine. But if you say we have a high return in 2 years, at the moment we don't, I can say, seriously, come on, how do you want to do that? That is a difference. If you have numbers, you have to have them ready. But in the moment you raise money, you don't have any numbers, go for the hockey stick.
So I think there's one more question here.
So, hi, really, it was a nice, inspiring speech. Really, I really, really liked it. So I have two questions. I'm also having a startup. And so actually quite the same story. I'm 26, out of business school. And when I'm comparing myself with my friends now, okay, they have a huge salary. Same story, consulting companies, banking, whatever. And I don't regret it. I love my startup, and as you said, I love waking up and going to work. But still, sometimes I think, okay, my salary, there's actually no, really, no
Let's
salary.
Not talk yeah, about
no,
it.
Don't let's talk about it. So, what is the solution for that? Or is that, did you work for, meanwhile, for another comp, or I don't know, some side jobs?
Well, for example, the first half of the equity that we had to give into the company, I took from all that I had saved during my studies. I have worked as a student consultant while studying. I've saved all my internship salaries during studying, and that all went into the company to pay the designer. Very good feeling. So that was the first thing, and afterwards we actually didn't pay us a lot of money. We had to deal with our investor because we actually gave up only a very tiny bit of percentages for him, but telling him we want to show you that we're not here to work for a big salary, but we're here to work for the idea. So what we did is we calculated how much money would we need to survive the month, told him the number, and he was okay with that. I didn't earn more than an intern at that time. Actually, interns were earning more in our company than we were. And there are still people who are earning way more than I do in the company. That is something that you always have to consider. It's really a pain point. And you actually, I, for example, did side jobs, like doing some analysis or whatsoever you can do from your PC. My co-founder, that's way easier. He has his software business still running because as an IT person, you just code one software and sell it. And it's constant cash flow, you have to do that. But actually, investors tend to not be really, let's say, angry at you if you say you need a salary. I mean, you have to pay your living. And actually, what you bring into the company, the reason why you hold percentages is because your salary is so low. So the easy math is to tell them, you know what, my expected salary would be, let's say, 60,000 euros. I'm working here for, let's say, 24,000 euros. So at the moment, without my work, just considering normal working times, I'm already putting in about 40,000 euros into this company. There is more to come because I'm way underrated at the moment. That is something that you can actually argue, and nobody will ever say no to that because investors are happy if founders are happy because happy founders work a lot, a shit lot. Because we had, for example, in Hamburg, one situation with a startup, a friend of mine that actually went down in the second round of financing because the founders were not owning, not even close to the majority. So all the investors that were to come in were saying, hey, if we invest in this company, the founder is actually going to hold that bit of it instead of that. And I'm not really sure whether a founder that holds that bit of a company is really interested in doing the best for the firm if he has the choice. And so I would say just talk to, if you have a business angel or whatever, make clear what is the minimum that you're actually happy with, and he'll be happy with it too, I guess. So that was the case for us, actually. After about 1 year, we told that we have to insure ourselves because it would be nice to be covered whenever a bus hits me, and he was totally fine with that. But it's hard.
Thanks. Okay, and second question is, so as a CEO, I find it sometimes quite hard to structure your day because you have so many things to do. Okay, you need investors, then you have to take care of the marketing, of everything, actually business development. So sometimes I'm sitting there and say, okay, what's next? What's priority? So this is a really...
It's a really tough task, especially because you cannot plan every day and you have to plan for the others as well. That is something that I learned the hard way. Having employees sounds good, but is a whole damn lot of work because you have to take care of their to-dos as well. It's not only your to-dos on the table, but you have to take care that they are actually doing their work. You have to assign work to them. So when you prioritize, what we always did is we wrote it down and looked at it together, like what is important, what is not. And structuring is really important because you tend to overdo some tasks. And that's something that I always do. You tend to tell yourself you still have a lot of time because if you cannot do it by 8 o'clock, I mean, you just sit in until 12 o'clock. That's easy. But with that perspective in mind, you will be highly inefficient. You have to set yourself time goals and to just wrap up at that time and tell everyone, okay, I did this, next is this, who has not met the goal? You really have to do that also with your employees because otherwise you tend to just stretch your day into night because that is something that we learned. If you in your mind have the option to just be longer in the office, you tend to be slower. So you have to have a pressure point in your day, like a fixed appointment where you have to appear with somebody extern that you just cannot miss, because if you have this pressure that is always working for me, pressure is awesome, you really do your stuff and you actually don't really think about prioritization anymore because you have so much pressure in there that you just do and run.
So we have, oh, it's a question over there.
I can just say,
wait for the microphone.
What did you use your first round of funding for? What was most pressing that you used it for?
It was in the period we were still developing the product, so we had to hire another developer. That was the first bunch of money that went in there, and you at the first moment don't really realize how much that costs. Second thing is actually marketing. Marketing is way more expensive than you think in the beginning. If you have never done anything in marketing, you will be shocked because starting at a marketing budget that is below 5,000 euros a month and 5,000 euros is the minimum, that's really low, is really not working out, not efficient. So we spend a lot of money on that, and the rest is employees and software.
Hi. I just want to know, how did you find out that your idea was a great idea? Did you have some feedback channel or some customer feedback loop or something like that? And second thing is it advisable to have only one idea for your business, or you should have 2-3 in pipeline so that if one goes,
it's not
a success, then you can always go to the other one?
Good question. First question, how do you know it's the right idea? First of all, well, for us, it's easy. It's a consumer product. I saw the need myself. I was sitting in the US and was thinking, why don't I have this? Because I tend to forget things all the time, especially products. But what we did is actually, we ask a lot of friends. We ask about 500 people from my friends, friends of friends, family, whatsoever. Would you use this? And we had those 500 persons also as a testing group. They were the persons testing it, giving us feedback, and telling us, okay, we need this idea. And then we presented to 1-3 online shops what we wanted to do because we needed them as partners. And they told us, oh, this looks quite interesting. That's a good idea. And that was the one where we realized, okay, this makes sense. Concerning the second question, should you have other ideas? Yes. You should have one clear goal, what your product is there for, because otherwise you lose weight when you try to realize it. But your business model will shift all the time. If it doesn't, you either have a 1 billion one-hit wonder, or you have something that you can just put to the grave because it doesn't work. You always shift your product, you always go other ways. For us, for example, we didn't expect that we could actually sell our software because we thought that our software is the consumer product, but there are At the moment, companies who are interested in having such a list, not for products, but for other things, that was something we never expected beforehand. And also, we didn't expect that we would have a B2B marketing channel that would be working after 1 year in business. But we do have it. So you should actually be ready for shifts. And the plan B is always good. You should always spend about 10% of your time with a plan B, because it can always just be a great fuck up somewhere on the way that you didn't expect to come. That's really the case. So also for you personally, not even concerning the idea, but also you personally, always talk to people, do networking, because there always should be this slight thought of the time after. So meet people that can help you in the time after to get in somewhere else or to do something else.
So there are plenty of drinks left and loads of pretzels, but there is one more question. So before we go on to the pretzels and the fruit roller, let him ask his question.
Hi, could you complete the project if you were not with a technical co-founder?
Perhaps, but rather no. I know a lot of startups that actually hired the developer who's not part of the company but just hired from extern, or that is just as a normal employee in the company. It might work if you find the motivated person, but A, that costs you a lot of money. If it's a software engineer, it always costs a lot of money. And second, that is something that I really appreciate about the fact that my co-founder is the technical engineer. He is going for perfection because it's his goddamn company. So if something runs wrong, it goes wrong, it's also his problem. If he were just employed and I was mad about something that went wrong for him, it would just be another working task. But for him, he's really thinking about how does that make sense in an economic way, and what does this mean to the company. And I would always go for a technical co-founder ever again, because he brought in other developers, and it also really, apart from his knowledge, looks really great to investors if you have the person building the product in the founding team.
So I think on that note, we will move to the networking part and say a huge thank you.